Skies, some light rain downtown Wausau. Temperature stands at 50 degrees here at our studios at the corner of Washington Street and North 3rd Street in downtown Wausau. I'm Chad Holmes. Welcome to the Thursday edition of the Chad Holmes Show here on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Online at bowfallsradio.com, mobile devices, and Alexa by searching WXCO, and on the Civic Media app. Coming up on the program today, we will be in the second hour talking to UW-Stevens Point Professor Ed Miller. Ed Miller, member of a local Jewish congregation here in Wausau, and also a professor at the University of Wisconsin-Stevens Point. We are going to talk to Professor Miller about the conflict between Israel and Hamas and try to get through some of the misinformation that has been put out there in the media and try to get right down to the core of what is happening in Israel with this war against Hamas. So Ed Miller coming up in the second hour of the program. Also coming up a little bit later on in this hour, we will be talking about another proposal that's been put out concerning school consolidation in Wausau. A member of the Wausau School Board has put out another proposal earlier this week in committee, and we'll be moving forward in terms of discussing it in front of the full board coming up in the next couple of weeks. And it's an idea that basically pulls back on the merger of Wausau East and Wausau West High School. And some ideas within that proposal I want to kind of delve into a little bit later on in this hour as well. So that's all coming up. But also, we are joined on Thursday mornings by Pat Kreitlow, host of Up North News. And with our clock changes, we're bringing in Pat a little bit earlier. I'm assuming this is Pat. Is this Pat?
Yeah, boy, it better be. You got some real issues there.
No, I just picked up the phone and I thought, I hope it's Pat.
Sometimes you open the door without looking through the peephole, but no, you're lucky enough that I looked at the clock and I thought, you know what? I didn't check with him if I should show up at 8:06 and I'll wait till 8:20. And I figured if there was one thing I could count on, the answer is more Pat.
Exactly.
So earlier, you know?
Hey, Pat, there's lots to talk about. I guess the first thing real quickly is I heard on our Civic Media News reports, actually during your program as I was tuned in, and another announcement within the University of Wisconsin system, this time from Platteville, that more jobs are going away. I was wondering if when these stories come across and Robin Voss sees it, does he chuckle? Does he put a big smile on his face? Because the way that he's methodically killing the University of Wisconsin system is really getting under my skin.
Well, look, I'll be a nice guy right now and say that the answer is no to the chuckling, and simply to say that it is in his mind and the mind of other far right conservatives, it's some kind of a victory to cut out things that they feel are unnecessary or superfluous or a luxury, when in fact these are the kinds of things that help an operation, you know, to be more efficient, to be more of a leader, to be better at what they do. And that is not to say that, you know, the UW system or anybody else should be getting a blank check. But, you know, a legislature's job, I believe, is to ensure that an already high quality university system stays that way. Whereas in their minds, if they, you know, cut things enough, it'll still be good enough. And I just think we should expect better than good enough from our elected leaders.
And also within this story, last year, or I mean, it all runs together now, but he actually said at one point that everything that the UW system does should be about growing the economy. Right. I, number one, disagree with that vehemently. And number two, he's not doing his part in order to, you know, allow the economy to grow as well. I mean, there's actually aspects of what he's trying to accomplish that's suffocating it in terms of making sure that we have the trained workers in the state of Wisconsin in different areas. But also at the same time, the whole idea, the premise of that statement, again, really annoys me to no end, because again, life is more than about growing the economy. Yes, it's vitally important. Yes, for the state of Wisconsin, it is very important. But at the same time, life is not about servicing the top 2%. And I just feel like everything that comes out of his mouth is about that.
That's exactly correct. It is. If there's anything that shows the difference between people on the left and the right, it's the viewpoint from the right that believes that everything should be done with an eye on the workforce rather than, you know, growing our civilization as people, as leaders, as thinkers. It shows a fundamental and deliberate misunderstanding of how an economy works best. And an economy works best when you are not just working for the people who are rich now, but you're helping educate the job creators of the future. And a lot of those come through, again, their own education at higher education levels and colleges, universities, tech colleges. And when you purposefully snuff out or strangulate that sector of your future, you're eating your seed corn. And that's what Wisconsin Republicans have been doing for the longest time here, is eating their seed corn, assuming that, you know, well, some other rich guy or rich woman will move in and create jobs. That Foxconn mentality, rather than the homegrown jobs that you get when you invest in your young people to get a high quality education here.
I really was glad to hear you talking today about Derek Van Orden and farms, Farm Bill. It seems as though this has not been a good couple of weeks for Derek Van Orden in terms of people that actually look at what we expect one of our Wisconsin representatives to Congress to do. And I think farming is still, even though it may not be at the same level that it was in the past, and I know that within your family, this is an issue that's very close to home. But man, that he is on that committee and not fighting for the farmers of Wisconsin is an outrage. And that's just the tip of the iceberg this week, where he wasn't even there yesterday to vote on the new speaker.
Yeah. In getting the Ag Committee assignment, which is a plum assignment, that wasn't about, you know, Derek Van Orden looking out for Wisconsin farmers and producers and processors and everything else. That was Derek Van Orden looking out for himself. That was Republicans looking in for him, saying, if we give you this prestigious committee assignment, it's going to help you win re-election. But for it to do that, you at least have to do something, anything. And right now, even before he literally went AWOL in Israel, he was doing nothing to truly stand up for family farms, for local farms, for homegrown farms, and instead, you know, buying into the whole Republican orthodoxy of, well, if you're good to the big corporations, including the big corporate farms and processors, it will somehow trickle down. It doesn't work that way. And if Derek Van Orden stands with his fellow Republicans who want to gut $50 billion from voluntary conservation programs and nutrition assistance programs, I mean, that'll get him Republican money, but it's sure not going to help him trying to get reelected in that third district.
In terms of what actually grows the economy, we kind of had a couple of different issues here in the past couple of minutes. Just this morning, well, 45 minutes ago, it was announced that the GDP grew 4.9% in the last quarter. And I don't think that's an accident, because I remember a few years ago when the bipartisan infrastructure bill was passed, the president and others within the administration said this is not something that is going to show its full impact right away. It's going to take a couple of years once the money and the work that is done within so many of the different areas of infrastructure in this country start to take root. And now we're seeing that. And we're seeing, again, an economic, I think, idea, an economic plan that is the opposite of trickle-down. And as the president has said, it's about growing out from the middle. And we are starting to see evidence of that. Is that going to seep through to most Americans?
I don't know. That's on, as we've discussed before, that's on Democrats to make that case. Because I promise you, there are people not just on the Republicans who are not on their side, but on the media. And as I'm looking at the New York Times story about this right now, you can bet your bottom dollar. One of my first questions to Mark Jacob when we do a little media critique tomorrow morning at 7:30 will be about this New York Times headline that says U.S. economic growth accelerated in the third quarter. Gross domestic product expanded at a 4.9% annual rate, powered by prodigious consumer spending. But... the pace is not expected to be sustained. Well, of course not, because that would lead to inflation.
Unbelievable.
It's just unbelievable what the New York Times and others will do to
both sides it. It's both sides
it. To Biden's critics.
Yeah. I mean, it's like, oh, I mean, that's... And we've heard for 3 years about the oncoming recession, and yet... And I swear nobody is understanding that there are reasons why we haven't gone into recession, that the policies that were put through in some very significant legislation over these last 3 years has kept the American economy growing. And yet there's no credit to be given.
I will again say that while Democrats should only blame themselves if they're not successful in messaging it. It is absolutely fair game to insist that when mainstream media report on the economy, that they don't both side something like this and give credit where credit is due.
And finally, yes, we do have a Speaker of the House, but at the same time, my thought is, in a sane system where you have what we have seen the last 3 weeks, you don't see the most right-wing religious conservative with a record that is so far right ultimately win this prize. I mean, yeah. It makes no sense. Instead of in any other system around the world, we would have seen some sort of coalition or some sort of centrist, but instead we actually have the most conservative of any of these candidates ultimately getting the votes. I mean, this is crazy, isn't it?
It is absolute capitulation. It is the final surrender of what was left of any moderate Republican faction in the U.S. House of Representatives. And I said this morning and say again, if you consider yourself a moderate Republican, you are currently homeless.
Yep, I think that hits it on the head. Well, Pat Kreitlow again, Up North News every weekday from 6 till 8 a.m. here on Bow Falls Radio and the Civic Media app. Have yourself a great Thursday. Thanks again for popping in early.
You bet. Thanks. See you later.
That is Pat Kreitlow. We're going to take a quick timeout. Come right back. More to come. I'm Chad. And welcome back. Chad Holmes with you here on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 to 1230. BowFallsRadio.com, mobile devices, and Alexa by searching WXCO. And on the Civic Media app. Apparently, we had a little technical issue in our last segment. I've been told that we had apparently another station on the air as well. We're currently in the midst of some changes. I think you may have noticed we've changed our clocks. We're changing our automation system, and some of the changes sometimes leak through where there's going to be a hiccup or two while the changes are made. So I apologize for that, and hopefully that will be taken care of, and we'll make sure that they gets fixed as quickly as possible. But thanks again to Pat Kreitlow for joining us here on this program. Usually he would come on at 8:15, but with the change of the clocks, it's a shorter segment here to the bottom of the hour, so we've moved Pat a little bit earlier in the program. Coming up after the bottom of the hour news update, I'm going to spend a little time talking about a new proposal that's been put out by Pat McKee of the Wausau School Board concerning school consolidation here in the Wausau School District. And I have a few thoughts on it. Again, it's just a situation where it's worrisome at this point. So I'm going to have some thoughts on that coming up when we have a few more minutes. I have a longer segment coming up after the bottom of the hour. Also coming up as well in the second hour of the show, we'll talk to UW Stevens Point Professor Ed Miller. He is somebody that you've seen on television on election nights. He is somebody that is, again, at UWSP for many years, and he's somebody that knows exactly what is happening when it concerns the Israeli-Hamas conflict. And we have seen in the last couple of weeks, and there was a very good example of it in the New York Times a couple of weeks back, where there was an explosion reported at a Hamas hospital. And the New York Times got reports from Hamas medical authorities saying that it was Israel that had bombed this hospital. Ultimately, that was not the case. And the information started coming in. It took days and days and days, and then finally, the New York Times was able to put out a statement that said, well, we're sorry that we put out this information. As more information came in, it looks to be that perhaps it was a bomb that was off target, actually, that was launched from Hamas. And again, we've seen a lot of that, and there's some good things that occur with the explosion of social media, of technology, where you're able to get so much information so quickly, but at the same time, you get so much bad information so quickly. And ever since Elon Musk took over Twitter and now turned it into X, he chuckles at misinformation. There was a story that I saw yesterday, and it's an odd place to see it, but The Hollywood Reporter and Brian Stelzer, who is the former media reporter for CNN, he wrote an article about some of the work that has been done by media folks that are on the ground in Israel near the Gaza Strip. And some of the reporting that was done by a CNN correspondent was then taken by bad actors, cut up in a very deceiving way, put on X, and then Elon Musk responded to it with a chuckle that, ha ha, basically, you know, this is funny stuff that's being done. No, it's not funny stuff. And the idea that the person that is in charge of that social media platform that so many people go to for information, so many people don't go to a website of the New York Times or the Washington Post or even your local news sources, whether a TV station or a radio station or newspapers in your own neighborhood. They go to Twitter looking for information. And I shouldn't say Twitter anymore. It is X. It's not Twitter anymore. Elon Musk is completely ruining it. He has decided that he doesn't care if there's misinformation out there. And as we go into another election year, that is scary, scary stuff. And that's why I want Ed Miller to come on, because he is somebody that, as I said, he is a member of a local Jewish community here in central Wisconsin. I reached out to somebody I know within the Wausau Jewish community because I wanted to get the real information out there, because it's so hard at times to find out what's true and what's not true. And when you have bad actors out there, and I will say the number one bad actor right now in social media is Elon Musk. It is incredibly disappointing that something that had been a real source for information in real time has turned into something where you have to wonder, is this true? Is this not true? And we're going to discuss what Ed Miller has seen, what Ed Miller knows, and try to put it in a way to explain what the issues are, who are the actors involved in this, and a little bit more. That's coming up in the second hour of the program when Ed Miller joins us from UW Stevens Point. So, again, I think it's an important discussion, and it's a part of a bigger discussion. This is obviously a huge discussion on its own, the war between Israel and Hamas. But when you add on the incredible amount of misinformation out there, that you have people that are just, you know, they are certain that what they're saying is right because they saw it on X. They saw it on some other social media platform. They saw it on the internet. The internet does not always have the best information. You need to be smarter than that. You need to vet the information as best as you know how. And it's harder and harder these days to be able to do that. And it's so disturbing. It's so scary that bad actors are able to get power because they're so very able to easily manipulate social media, able to manipulate the internet. And it's so much easier for bad actors to get together now. Before the internet, before social media, before the technological explosion we've seen in recent decades, if you were just a crazed person in your basement, it was a lot harder to be able to find fellow thinkers. But nowadays, you're able to do that. It's hard to believe. I mean, we are basically a year away from the general election of 2024. And that doesn't even count the primaries and the nominating processes for the major political parties in this country, not to mention the statewide races, the local races that are all coming in 2024. It's going to be a job and a half for anybody to try to get through the misinformation that we're going to see in 2024. We've heard about the misinformation of the 2016 campaign. We've heard about the misinformation of the 2020 campaign. And now I think it's going to be even more difficult in 2024. So, again, it's something we're going to try to get through. We're going to try to get the best available facts out there, whether it's on our programs or whether our newscast as well on Bull Falls Radio. We're going to take a time out, have a look at what the latest information is from CBS News and also Civic Media News that's straight ahead. I'm Chad Holmes. It is 8:29, almost 8:29, the Chad Holmes Show, Bull Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, bullfallsradio.com, mobile devices and Alexa by searching WXEO and on the Civic Media app. And welcome back. Chad Holmes with you here on Bull Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Online at bullfallsradio.com. Mobile devices and Alexa by searching WXCO and on the Civic Media app. The rain is falling. Yep, looking outside the window here from our downtown studios, the rain has started to come down a little bit harder. Temperature stands at 51 degrees. It should, again, be a fairly mild day, but boy, it's going to be another wet day. After the downpours that we saw on Tuesday, it looks like more significant rain throughout the course of the day. Things are going to start to cool down in the next couple of days, especially for the weekend. And in fact, we could see a little bit of snowfall as we get into the weekend. We'll find out if it's anything significant when we talk to Jennifer Vuchiski from Weatherology, our daily visit with Jennifer coming up at 9:06. And again, also in this hour, we'll be talking to Ed Miller from UWSP as we'll talk about the issues right now with Israel and Hamas, with Ed Miller coming up in the second hour of the program. Haven't had a chance to say hello and good morning to our in-studio engineer, Ian Welsh, this morning. And Ian, first of all, thank you again for being here and good morning.
Good morning, Chad. Happy to be here.
Yeah, it's another wet one, though. Boy, oh boy. I mean, it's just been one of those weeks where it'd be nice to see a little bit of sunshine, see a little bit of something to put a smile on the face, because right now it just continues to be very dreary to start off the day.
Absolutely. You know, the temperatures the next week are supposed to get down into the 30s,
yeah.
I saw.
So get out the winter jackets. It's that time of year. As in fact, we'll be going into the month of November next week. So again, we're getting closer and closer to winter itself. But again, a lot of moisture out there today, a lot of rain, and we'll keep you up to speed on the weather as we continue throughout the morning. Also, I came across again a story this week that we have been talking and hearing a lot about the consolidation of the Wausau School District over the past year or so. And it just seems as though that the divide continues. And in fact, now there is a member of the Wausau School Board that is putting out a new proposal to basically stop what has been occurring throughout the course of this year. Because it was very early this year, back in January, that the Wausau School Board approved the consolidation plan that would merge Wausau West and Wausau East high schools, add a couple of new junior high schools, have, again, Horace Mann and John Muir taken down a couple of notches, have some consolidation and changes within the elementary schools as well. Major, major, major changes here in the city of Wausau and the Wausau School District. And the and after that occurred back in January, the school district has been moving forward as the plan is for the total consolidation of the schools. Wausau East and Wausau West into a new Wausau High School would be starting in the fall of 2025, which again is not that far off. But now, here in late October, another alternative to the restructuring plan has been put out by Pat McKee, a Wausau school board member, who has been one who's been, as put by Shireen Seward in the Wausau Pilot Review, somebody that's consistently questioned the details behind the district's restructuring plan. Well, he introduced a proposal Monday in committee. McKee calls for keeping the existing middle school and high school structure, continuing referendum projects as approved by taxpayers, and diverting expenses for added busing, mascots, and branding changes to what he called, quote, value-added services, such as hiring additional educators. McKee presented the proposal to counter what he called the district's current field of dreams approach, which he says assumes, quote, if we build it, the 239 students who are transferred out will return. He said his plan is the first step in beginning to rebuild trust from within the community. He calls his proposal a clear path for students while eliminating the uncertainty that he says has left parents reeling. There have been more than 2,000 people who've signed a petition to hold a referendum prior to moving forward on Superintendent Keith Hill's vision for restructuring. But so far, those calls have been rejected. Hiltz has said that he calls the referendum idea a mistake. Again, this is very much an issue that has split people within the community. Part of the proposal that has been put out by Pat McKee, while keeping Wausau West and Wausau East and the current middle school structure intact, there are multiple reasons why this consolidation plan has been put forward and approved by the board. It's not just about enrollment, which is a major factor. It's not just about the finances, which is a major factor. It's also about equal opportunity. And one thing that I think people need to take a look at is the current Wausau School Board. How many of the school board members are from families that have children that go to Wausau West? And how many have children that go to Wausau East? I think you'd be surprised. Also, in terms of trying to have equal access, equal opportunity, there are socioeconomic issues at play here. And while most, if not the entirety of the school board has family members that are, we consider Wausau West families, Wausau East is being left behind. And one aspect of McKee's proposal is to change the scheduling, because right now at Wausau West, you have what's called flex mod scheduling. And at Wausau East, they have what would be considered, I think, traditional scheduling in terms of, you know, the bell would ring and you go to the next class. Well, McKee says that he would change to have both Wausau West and Wausau East implement the same scheduling system to allow for classes to be taught in combination of virtual and in-person. Well, it's not that easy. Wausau West and Wausau East have facilities that are different. Wausau East was built on the model of not having the flex mod scheduling system. Wausau West has different size rooms in terms of bigger rooms and smaller rooms because they do have flex mod scheduling. So it's not that simple as to say, well, we want both schools to have one or the other, whichever one they decide. It does not appear to say within this proposal that was put out by McKee. And the idea that you can have the changes within the elementary school and then not have the changes within the middle school and the senior high schools are, I think, problematic at best. And again, and I think as we've talked about over the past year, you can have criticism of the way the process has gone along. But the idea that the consolidation plan is on its face the wrong thing to do, I think, is false. And I know that many people out there who are tuned in right now may be disagreeing with me that this should be stopped and should be stopped at, you know, by any way possible. I mean, I have heard people say, well, you know, you want to try to even things up, just change the border. Well, you can't. Anybody who has a history of that idea in Wausau knows how difficult that has been. And even if you do change the border between east and west, one of the probably simplest ways of moving the border would involve some of the poorest areas of town. And that would exacerbate the difference in terms of the socioeconomic factors at Wausau East compared to Wausau West. There are issues with busing that are beyond even this issue of consolidation. The idea, again, there was a parent that spoke earlier this week about, again, having a child that has to go 60 minutes each way. The busing issues are beyond the idea of the consolidation. There are busing issues because First Students had issues having enough bus drivers. And that's a problem that we've seen throughout the state of Wisconsin, in fact. So, again, the concern here is that we're going back to the drawing board after a vote early this year that approved the consolidation. And over the last 9-10 months, the district has been moving forward on that. And now all of a sudden you got this major change, major change with, I think, some fallacies within it, as I said, in terms of the scheduling and others. Because you have to look at it, again, with the big picture lens. You have to look at it in terms of the equal opportunities. And the idea here is to add another business teacher, and all of a sudden that's going to be equal for Wausau East? No, it's not. There are a lot of issues involved here, and there's a fear now that you're going to pull back, and you're still going to have major issues. And the idea that this idea is going to save all this money, I have my doubts. Again, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe as the process continues, McKee said that over the next couple of weeks, he wants to be able to let people look at the idea, be able to digest the idea, then move forward within the council, within the school board. But again, it just feels as though if you're going to start this process, this road with this idea, it's not as simple as saying, oh, this is a wonderful idea, let's vote for it right now. I just don't see that happening. And again, I have had the opportunity through my work, I've been, you know, been around the schools, especially Wausau West, in terms of covering high school athletics. The people I talk to within that building have been basically unanimous that the consolidation is the way to go. And again, I trust, and I know there's, you could say, why do you trust these people? Well, I've dealt with a lot of these people for many years, and I don't think they're trying to pull the wool over my eyes when I have these discussions. I know there are people out there who are aggressive. I know there are very active people who are trying to stop this consolidation plan. I know that hearing me say this probably upsets them. But at the same time, based on the information I have, based on what I know, and again, that's all I can do is try to get the best information possible from the people that I feel like I can trust to say what is the best way forward for the Wausau School District. And for those folks I have talked to, it's been basically a almost unanimous who within the building, within the district, who have been able to see some of these issues, that the best way forward is the plan that was passed back early this year. And now we're getting some nervousness within the board. The board is the one that voted for this. And if we're going to start now getting the shakes here, at some point you're going to have to stand up and say, this is where we're going. This is where we're going for this district. And if it's McKee's plan, then you better go full speed ahead, because there are still major issues, and we have to make sure, again, for the students of this district, that we do have equal opportunity, equal access, and the equal chance to be successful within these school districts. And again, for the members, again, who are great majority, if not almost completely, from Wausau West families, they have better make sure that the folks on the east side are treated as fairly as well. So again, it's just something they have to keep an eye on. But again, Mr. McKee brought out this proposal earlier this week, a bit of a surprise, I think, to some. But he says he wants to take the time here now over the next couple of weeks to be able to let people vet and look at this plan, and that's a good thing as well. So we'll see where we head over the next couple of weeks when the Wausau School Board continues to meet, and I'm sure we'll have some very active and very energetic discussions on this issue. The time is 8:48. Again, overcast skies, a little bit of light rain out there, 51 degrees. I'm Chad Holmes, Chad Holmes Show, Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230. Chad Holmes Show on Bow Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230, online at bowfallsradio.com, mobile devices and Alexa by searching WXCO, and on the Civic Media app. The time is 8:52, some light rain, overcast skies, 51 degrees in Wausau. Again, in about 15 minutes, we'll be joined by Jennifer Vucheski to talk about the weather forecast for the end of the work week and into the weekend. Also, then in the second hour, we'll talk as well to Ed Miller, UW Stevens Point professor, and somebody, a member of the an area synagogue here in central Wisconsin, and talk about what's going on in terms of the Israeli-Hamas conflict, the war going on right now, and try to get some real information from Ed Miller on that coming up in the second hour of the program. A little bit of sports to talk about. Every time I've talked to some folks about Wisconsin sports, and of course tomorrow we'll again have our Friday visit with Paul Mickleg about Wisconsin sports, and he's always said that Craig Counsell is not going anywhere. If he doesn't manage the Milwaukee Brewers, he won't be managing at all. Well, maybe not so fast, because there was a story in The Athletic yesterday talking about Craig Counsell and how he looks as being a free agent as an opportunity to raise the bar for manager salaries. And manager salaries lag well behind player salaries, despite the importance that a manager does have. And Craig Counsell, as a free agent, is going to be speaking to the New York Mets. In fact, he's going to have an interview with the New York Mets. So while Counsell is somebody that actually lives in Wisconsin year-round, somebody that loves Wisconsin, somebody that's a Wisconsin native, he is going to try to lift salaries for managers and force Mark Antanasio to come to the plate with a market level contract offer. And that's a good thing. That's a good thing. People shouldn't be saying, oh, he's trying to be greedy. No, Mark Antanasio is getting plenty of money right now, basically, as we're continuing the process to have the Wisconsin State Legislature and the governor sign into law a lot of money for the upgrade of American Family Field, and for the honor of Mark Antanasio telling us he won't move the team. Mark Antanasio has been known from time to time not to spend wildly, which is a fine. You know, obviously the Brewers have done pretty well. Haven't won the World Series yet, but they've done very well in recent years. But Craig Counsell is not going to say, well, Mark, whatever you want me to pay, I just love being here. Nah, that's not the way it works. Craig Counsell now, as a free agent manager, has a little bit of leeway, a little bit of opportunity here to tell Mark, hey, if you don't come to the plate with a fair offer, I have other opportunities. And there's no doubt about it that if Craig Counsell wanted to go to New York or wanted to go to Cleveland or wanted to go to Anaheim, wherever there's a managerial opening right now, or San Diego, he would be the number one choice for all these teams. So what has happened is that the Brewers have granted early permission to organizations to speak to Counsell, even though his contract does not expire for another 5 days until October the 31st. And this way, all parties can get a jump start on the process. But basically, according to this article from The Athletic, nothing is inevitable. Just because Craig Counsell is going to go talk to the New York Mets and talk to his old boss, David Stearns. Of course, David Stearns just was named the new executive president of baseball operations for the New York Mets. And Stearns and Counsell had a very successful run of Brewer baseball from 2015 to 2022. In fact, from 2018 to 2021, the Brewers advanced to the playoffs each season with Stearns and Counsell working as a team, setting a franchise record and tying the number of times they previously reached the postseason altogether. And you cannot underestimate the opportunity that Steve Cohen, the owner of the New York Mets, he is baseball's richest owner, and he could make Counsell the highest paid manager in baseball. And I think one way or the other, there's a pretty good chance that Craig Counsell could become the highest paid manager in baseball because of the situation, because he is a free agent. He's going to have, I think, multiple teams bidding for his services. And obviously, it's not just going to be about the money for Counsell. It's about the best fit. But the idea that there's no way that Wisconsinite, loyal Wisconsinite Craig Counsell would leave the Milwaukee Brewers and go anywhere else, well, I'm starting to think that that is not exactly true. It doesn't mean he is going to leave, but the fact that he's talking to other teams is something that fans have to keep an eye on. And Counsell has openings. In fact, I mean, we just saw the Houston Astros lose in Game 7 of the American League Championship Series. The thought is that Dusty Baker is going to retire from the Astros. Obviously, that's a franchise that's been very successful. That would be an opportunity. The San Diego Padres have had one of the highest payrolls in Major League Baseball, have a lot of talent. Obviously, they would be somebody that would be interested. And also, there's been rumblings that the Cleveland Guardians are very interested in talking to counsel. Cleveland had made Terry Francona, their previous manager, one of the highest paid managers in baseball as well. And then, of course, there is the LA Angels. I don't think Council's heading to the Angels. That's a franchise a bit in disarray lately, despite the fact they have one of the best players in Major League Baseball in Mike Trout. They have had Ohtani, but he's a free agent. Does not look like he's coming back to the Angels. So, again, it's going to be very interesting. And you know that Mark Antanasio right now is probably not so thrilled. I think he was probably hoping that Craig Counsell would come back at whatever number he wanted to give him. Well, that's not going to be the case. In fact, Counsell may be doubling or even more than that his next contract wherever he decides to manage. Almost 9 o'clock, 8:58. We're going to have CBS News at the top of the hour, and then we'll get set for hour number two of the program. I'm Chad Holmes, Chad Holmes Show, Bull Falls Radio, 98.9 and 1230.